Thank you very much. Yesterday I spoke on KP hierarchy, and today I'll be speaking on topological recursion. These two subjects, as I told you, have many striking similarities. There is a nice space of solutions. There will be a nice group of symmetries acting on both, and so on. And there is another similarity, and also striking, that people working in the area usually present the results in such a way that nobody from outside would not be able to enter. So I will present my own version of topological recursion, which is actually equivalent to the standard one. And well, I do not insist that my version is better. Anyway, fortunately, I have a chance to compare. At least, for instance, yesterday Dima presented a recursion for Hurwitz numbers, and I'm wondering if after his talk you are able to reconstruct some Hurwitz numbers from this recursion. So this kind of recursion appeared first in matrix models, and one of the first versions of this recursion appeared in the paper of Mironov, Morozov, and Alexandrov. Then there was a paper also on two matrix models of Inar, Rantan, and Chekhov. And then it happens usually, the reference to all Russians disappeared, and now it's often referred to as Inar, Rantan, Bernard Rantan, and Inar and Rantan recursion, yeah. So I will be trying to use natural term topological recursion, just like this, if you won't mind. So another thing that I want to tell you, that this night I tried to modify my code, and it was completely, after all, it was completely broken, so that I will present only half of my computer experiments. So actually, the last part doesn't work at the moment. But let me just give you some initial part, which works pretty well. So what topological recursion does? So we have many problems where the data, the combinatorial data related to the problems are collected in a single generating series called the potential or partition function. So the coefficients, the amount of coefficients is the same as the amount of all possible partitions. So all this data are collected in a single generating series. And we have seen several examples like Hurwitz series, Witten-Kontsevich potential, and also Bell-Peterson volumes, and so on and so on. And there will be many other examples in the talk of Bertrand, I suppose. The topological recursion is a kind of ansatz which produces the coefficients of the series one by one using some data which are given as the input of this procedure. To be correct, the recursion actually goes not for the function itself. So if I have a function and there is one extra formal parameter which is called, which is responsible for the genus, and n stands for the part which is homogeneous in t variable of degree n. So the idea is to compute this one by one by induction g and n.
So you can explain what is also in red capital N equal 1. What does it signify in the title?
For the moment, I discuss the general case. So the first examples will be devoted to the n equal to 1. and I will explain later.
There's also some misprint, I see immediately. UGN is sum over alpha DFGN, should be.
Yes.
Yeah, in the formula for UGN on the second line.
Yeah, yeah, there's a subscript, yeah. Thank you. So, what we actually compute is not the function itself, but its differential. So the collection of its partial derivatives. So let's consider this differential df, which is this combination of partial derivatives, and let me treat this differential of the variable t dt alpha just as a new independent variable, as a whole symbol. And in order to emphasize that I treat it just as an abstract symbol, I will denote it in a different way, just xi. So xi alpha stand as a replacement for dt alpha. So we have a function which is ugn is, my notation is derivative of the function of this one, which is the sum of a partial derivatives times xi alpha. So this element, I treat this element as an element, as a formal linear combination of xi, and the linear span of xi is denoted by L. So I treat this element as an element of this vector spell L. And with coefficients in T. Also, there's another data which is used is a dual space. So I consider the dual space V with a dual basis xi alpha star with a dual basis. I copy here some parts of the screen because I want you to look at this later on. And then let me consider the space which is the sum of this L plus V. And also let me denote by P the projection to the first vector. So for the moment, this is could be done for any function. The recursion doesn't imply it yet. But now, what actually is used for the recursion is the following data. It happens that this total space H, the sum of L and the dual, it should be equipped with the structure of associative algebra. I will show you how it works in the examples. And then we have this recursion, and it uses some also data. So what there is a, this what I denote by T bold is a just a linear combination of these vectors. So xi alpha is a basis in this dual space V, and this is a linear combination with the coefficients depending on T. So you can treat it as a generic point of this space V. So for me, it will be a point of V with coefficients which depend on T in a linear way. But anyway, I could consider the coefficients as the functions of T.
So because the first line kind of suggests that there are infinitely many T's, they will be integers.
Finitely many
variable t, yeah.
T T0 infinitely many.
Infinitely many.
Yeah. The just as yesterday.
It's the same. It's labeled by integers.
Labeled by integers, like yesterday. All these potentials here. And there will be also some.
But also homogeneous in T means that T0 has degree zero.
No, just usually TK has degree one.
Degree one, okay.
Usual homogeneous homogeneity. Okay. And also I will need one extra data, which I call shifted origin, which is eta, is a particular point of this space. Some fixed vector, and the only thing that I suppose that it should be invertible. Okay, so this is the initial data of the recursion, and now let me formulate the recursion itself. It's written here. What do we do? First, we apply this operator. So we apply this operator to our function u, sub g minus 1 n plus 1. Thank you. I do not need this. Later. So how this operator acts? So I recall you that this is a point of L with coefficient depending on T. So first we differentiate with respect to parameters, and then we multiply by xi using the multiplicative structure in H. So this is. Here we have a point means the multiplication in this algebra H. And again, the second sum again here when we multiply we use this multiplicative structure in H. And also, let me add some more term.
So H is infinite dimensional.
H is infinite dimensional. Everything is infinite dimensional. So probably you will see immediately in the example how it works. So I take this huge expression. It belongs to H. So you use this to here use the multiplication in H, and there is one extra step. I wish to divide this over 2 times eta. So this is still an element of H, and I want to relate this to the newly computed term of our recursion. But the right hand side, the left hand side is an element of V, but the right hand side is not. So we just ignore the V component of this right hand side and project just to the left hand to the first summand. And this is UGN. So let me show how it works in examples. I will assure you that after some examples, you will see how it works. So the first example is a Witten-Kontsevich potential. So Witten-Kontsevich potential is the intersection number, generic function for intersection number of psi classes on the modular spaces of curves with marked points. So this is my implementation of this work. Wait a minute. This is my implementation of this function. Yeah, now it works. This is the actual definition needs some way to compute it, so I use for the actual computation, I use the Virasoro constraints. So this is the Virasoro constraints. These are the Virasoro constraints. So on the left-hand side, we have this differential operator, which involves partial derivatives and also sometimes second-order partial derivatives and also linear terms and some factorial coefficients. And the right-hand side is almost always zero, except for the case m equal to minus 1 and 1. There are some corrections. And yesterday I wrote this Virasoro constraints for the exponential of this generating function. Here I wrote for the function itself, so the nonlinear term appears here. Instead of the second partial derivative, we have a product of first partial derivatives. And also another distinction that here I use the genus expansion, so it implies that I should put here this formal parameter h. Anyway, these are well-known Virasoro constraints for the Witten conserved potential. Now let us do the following trick. Let's combine all these equations together in a single one in this following way. I introduce an extra new variable x, new formal variable x, and sum up all these equations, solve these equations with this factor. So I put x to the negative power m plus 1 multiplied by the left-hand side of the Virasoro equation. Then it happens that using this trick, one can write these equations in the very nice compact form. So for instance, what happens if we sum up this term? If we sum up this term with this coefficient, we obtain an expression which is exactly our function u, which is this one. So this sum will appear if we sum up to the shift of m plus 1. This is just the same. So summing up this term with this coefficient, we obtain what I denote by u here. Similarly,
this function u contains you should have forgot xi.
Yeah, so so let me write it here. So let me denote just by this coefficient by xi. Xi sub n is equal to 2m plus 1 double factorial divided by 2x to the power n plus 1. And then u is sum of 2n plus 1 double factorial divided by 2x to the power n plus 1 times the partial derivative. This is xi n df over dtn. Similarly, here, when you take this double sum and collect all these terms, you have just product of two things like this. So the left-hand side, this term turns into the function u. This term turns into product of the u squared. So here you have u, here have u squared. Then this sum containing second order partial derivatives is equivalent to applying this delta. This delta to the function u. So u already contains first order partial derivative of f. If you apply this delta, you obtain second order derivatives. And also there will be these factorial factors will appear twice. First, when you take the coefficient xi, which is already in u, and then this extra coefficient.
So when you write xi n equals something, do you mean it's actually a way to introduce the algebra structure?
Yeah.
Because so in your notation, xi n is just a...
Yes, yes. The algebra will be H. In our case, this will be the ring of Laron polynomial in X. So L will be the negative part of this, polar part of this. And V will be the regular part.
That's how you get the multiplication in H.
Yeah, yeah. This is the algebra structure in H.
So in general, you should have a curve, a smart point, and formal coordinates, something like this again.
If you wish. You may interpret it in the way you wish, but this is one of the possibilities, right? So this is how I interpret these terms. There is also this term, which is probably most interesting. So it also has this kind of sum appears if you sum up over all possible indices I and M. This sum appears to be the product of two power series. The first one is U, which contains partial derivative of F. And there will be another series which contains these linear terms in T. So let me write here T. So this stands for xi n star. But if you take the product t times u, it happens that this product contains much more terms. This sum, which is used here, is only some part of this product. And there will be also the terms containing positive powers of x. So we have some limitation on the summation indices, which implies that when you take the product, so you see that this t has terms of increasing order in positive also degree in x, and this xi has negative powers of x. When you multiply, you obtain both terms of positive and negative degrees. So here, the terms which we appear in this summation correspond to only those parts which has negative degree in x. Therefore, the left-hand side is not zero, but there is some contribution of this term in the positive, in the regular part of x. So the conclusion that if you apply this expression, all Laurent part of the expression will cancel, and also the only part which remains is some regular function in X. So this is how it works. So I do not compute the left-hand side, the whole left-hand side, but only I drop the positive part in X. So you may, for instance, look at the next term, that it's really non-zero. So you see, the positive part, it does exist, but if you just drop it, then it becomes much nicer. So this is the equation on U, and there are several equivalent forms. So for instance, if I divide by 2x here, so there are just formal manipulation of this. I can divide by 2x, and here, or I can extract the complete square, so I will get the equations of this type. So these are two possible ways to represent the same equation. And let me write the resulting formulas here. H bar times delta U plus contribution 1 over 8x plus U plus T minus, and this is what I denote by eta. This is of x. So eta in this particular case, eta is equal to x. And another form of the same equation is this one, that if you take U minus 1 over 2 times eta H bar delta U plus U plus T squared and so on. That's all. Is equal to the, well, up to the term which is known, which is corresponds to regular part. So these are, this is an equivalent form of the Virasoro equations. Now, if you look just at this and take the homogeneous part in G and N in G, so we extract the coefficient of a particle power of H and also homogeneous term of the fixed degree in N. So these are the equations that we obtain finally. So this is just our recursion relation could be combined in a single equation. So this is what I called master equation. And so these are, should wait a little bit. I hope it should work. Thinking, still thinking. Yeah. So the recursion relation holds for all G and N except for some initial values, which for G equal to 1 and equal to 1, and G equal to 0 and equal to 3, which are initial terms of our recursion, and it should be given explicitly in a different way. I will explain, discuss it later. So, anyway, so what do I claim? That for our particular case, there are Virasoro constraints, and that just by a formal manipulation, we could represent them in a different form, either using this master equation or this recursive procedure, which is a reformulation of the topological recursion. And these are just the same relations. So the topological recursion from my point of view is just a reformulation of Virasoro constraints. Okay, so this is the equation that I hope you are able to apply, because just compute the right hand side, ignore the regular part, take the Laurent part, and this will represent the next term of this recursion. It's very simple to implement. The next example that I would like to present you is the following genetic function, which is modified from I modify the Witten-Kontaveit potential by adding so-called kappa classes. So kappa classes are another interesting classes in the modular spaces of curves, which also appear quite often in some applications. So consider MGN plus 1 bar, and consider the forgetful map, which given by just forgetting erasing marking from one of the marking points. In the yesterday Dimas talk, this could be identified also with the universal curve. So here we have n marked points, and we have here n classes, psi 1, psi n, associated to these marked points, which are first term classes of the corresponding associated cotangent line at the ith mark point. And here we have also these classes, which are, and there are n plus 1 of this type. Those classes whose indexes from 1 to n are related a little bit in a certain way to these classes which are here. Namely, here we have psi I in this space are just more or less the same as pullback of the classes psi I on the bottom up to slight correction, which is divisor here. Divisor in this modular space, which consists of curves which are singular and has two points number I and n plus 1 bubbled in a separate rational component, and there are some other marked points inside. So these classes could be related to this one once, but the last one is just completely new. There is no relation between this class and the classes on the bottom. And therefore, using this class, one can produce new cohomology classes on the bottom, which is called Marita-Marmor classes. Kappa sub k is push forward of the powers of this class. This push forward decreases grading by 1, so we take k plus first power of psi in order to obtain kappa k. So we consider all possible monomials in kappa classes, multiply by suitable, and organize them as in generating series, which is now will be series in both T and S. I use this S as formal parameters, but one can also fix them in any arbitrary way. So this is generating series whose coefficients involve all possible intersection numbers for kappa classes and psi classes. Okay. But now,
psi is two-dimensional, but kappa is not.
Okay, the same. Yeah, so kappa k is belongs to cohomology of degree of real degree 2k. And now let me formulate the statement that actually this function could be reduced to Kontaveit-Witten potential by a simple substitution. So consider there are certain polynomials in S variables, which are written here. And we just make a shift in the Witten-Kontaveit potential. So the variables T0, T1 are not shifted, but then we shift T2 by S1, shift T3 by this polynomial, and so on. And this will be, this is how all this complicated power series could be combined. This result, implicitly, this is known for many years, but it seems that it's never been formulated explicitly. We discussed this with, there are some certain special cases. For instance, there is a paper of Zogrov-Manion where this statement is asserted for t equal to 0, right? Yeah, but this is just slight modification of the same arguments. Anyway, so the conclusion that this is just the same Witten-Kontsevich potential with a shifted arguments. So in particular,
excuse me, it was mentioned that it's related to Wiley-Patterson.
Yes. So there is the class which is Kappa 1. So it happens that this class Kappa 1 has a nice interpretation in terms of Riemann geometry of surfaces. So this is just the same as the class of the Weyl-Petersson symplectic form up to a factor which is 2 times p squared. I don't remember. Inverse. Yeah, so the computation of Weyl-Petersson volumes could be reformulated in terms of algebraic geometry just as a computation of intersection indices involving just Kappa 1. So for instance, the generating series that Dima mentioned in the last talk is just a specialization of this for when we ignore all Kappa classes other than Kappa 1. And in particular, again, it's the generating series for Weyl-Petersson volumes is obtained from the Witten-Kontsevich potential by a shifter of arguments. Only we put here, you use only S1, and S2, S3 are set to 0. So it's very nice, very simple interpretation in terms of intersection theory on moduli spaces. Okay. And as a conclusion, we obtain that these generating functions obeys Virasoro constraints. So the shift of the argument does not change the Virasoro equations. The only thing that here we have the partial derivatives are the same. The term t appears only in this coefficient. It was just t for the Witten-Kontsevich. Here we have this shift by the polynomial q. So it's a very simple equation. And again, using the same procedure, we can combine all these Virasoro equations to write them in this form. And it happens that they are just the same. Everything is the same age, the same basis in V and L. The only thing that is changing is just the choice of this eta, which I called the shifted origin. So we still use the Q polynomials to shift the origin. So we just modify H, and the rest remains the same. Yeah, so it works. So you just apply, you apply just the same relations. The only thing comparing with the Witten-Kontsevich case, you just modify this eta. So, and the one more example is what is called another modification. Instead of lambda Kappa classes, I will use in the same way lambda classes. So I will consider generating function which contains all possible Hodge integrals involving all possible combinations of lambda classes. But let me represent all polynomials and lambda classes in the following way. First of all, instead of lambda classes, I will use homogeneous component of the Chern character for the Hodge bundle. Lambda classes are Chern classes of the Hodge bundle, and instead of lambda of Chern classes, I will pass to the Chern characters. Besides, there is a result of Mumford, which claims that the even components of the Chern characters of the Chern character are zero, so only odd components remain. So we have only generators of degree 1, 3, 5, and so on. And besides, I will use a slight rescaling of the components of the Chern character by this factor.
Just small correction. In English, it's character.
Character. Okay, thank you. So I rescale the components of the Chern character by this scaling factor, which will be convenient for further references for the Mumford formula. So given any polynomial in lambda, we can rewrite this as a polynomial in mu classes. So mu is just another distinguished collection of cohomology classes on the modular spaces. And I take this generating function, which contains all possible combinations, all possible monomials in these mu classes. So every intersection number involving lambda classes can be found in this function. By some reason, it is called the obtained generating function is called potential of n equal to 1 cohomological field series. So see here n equal to 1 appears. I will consider also the case of n greater than 1, but for the n equal to 1?
Yeah, it's kind of, in physics, n equal to 1, it's supersymmetry. It's kind
of no, it's another n. It's another dimension. Dimension of the.
It's also to be best, you have also misprint. Mu m is an h of 2i, maybe 2m. Mm-hmm. Plus me.
Thank you. I'm happy that you're following carefully. Okay, so in particular, if you put instead of these parameters just with these coefficients, then this term becomes just total Hodge class. So the Hodge potential for single lambda classes, which appears in the ELSV formula and also in the generating function for Hurwitz numbers, is a specialization of this for this particular choice of the parameters R.
So now the left-hand side also depends on the R parameters and the T parameters.
So I consider T as a parameters of my manipulation which participate in the recursion, and R just supplementary parameters which are not involved in the recursion. So you can fix any parameter R, and we have the same recursion. So this is, you may treat it as a family of functions. For each parameter value R, you have the same recursion.
But where is T's on the right hand side?
This is probably not the best way to write this. This is a Taylor coefficient of this series. So here N is the degree of this monomial. So the left hand side is a number.
It's the derivative
at
T. It's
0. Actually, it's 0. If you wouldn't put n here, you should put here 0. But this is homogeneous of degree n. So this on the left hand side you have a constant. Well, you may...
Constant. No, it's a function of R.
Well, if you wish, I can write it this way. If you sum up all these terms with different n, are you happy now? Just the same. Okay, so so this is my implementation. Mu is a homogeneous term of degree m of this expression, rescaled by these Bernoulli numbers. B is the Bernoulli number, of course. And here, to simplify computations, I specify in some random way the constant r, not the same as the Hodge integrals, but just in a random way. And there is, I mentioned already, the Mumford's formula for the lambda classes. And this could be reformulated in this way, that the expansion with respect to parameter r could be described by this partial differential equation. In fact, the original Mumford formula was formulated not in terms of intersection numbers, but in terms of the classes themselves. And they could be written as follows. So take this mu class in the cohomology MGN. And this could be written in the following way. Probably minus mu, to be correct. So first of all, we have the class, which is a kappa sub m, which is push forward of psi n plus 1 to the power m plus 1, I recall you. Where P is a forgetful map. Then minus what we have, sum of psi classes increased to the power m, and plus the class, which is will be of this form. Psi n plus 1 to the power I, psi n plus 2 to the power j. So this class is supported on the boundary divisor of the modular space. We have our curve split, our curve has is double point. It could be either the double point could either divide the curve into two parts, or it could be the curve might be still connected. But anyway, this divisor could be regarded as an its own modular space, which admits two extra marked points, which I enumerate by indices n plus 1 and n plus 2. So it has many components, and any of the components could be regarded as a modular space with two extra marked points. And so I take this class supported on this boundary points, boundary divisor. So it's just a matter of combinatorics to reformulate this Mumford formula in terms of intersection numbers of classes, and it will get this form.
So
some small misprint. In the middle form, exponent of 1 over h bar f lambda is equal to exponent minus the separator. And then another, the same guy. So maybe the thing is evaluated when r equal to 0.
So here is the function itself, and this is the initial function, which is, of course, Witten-Kontsevich.
Maxim, and what is J star over there that push forward from where to where?
So let me denote this divisor somehow sigma. And J star is just the embedding of this divisor. This is
OMGN plus 2. What's the?
No, embedding of some divisor.
Embedding of the divisor. Here we have two more marked points coming from the gluing. And here we have just n points. So we have n plus 2 points here and n points here.
Could you please write on the blackboard what is f lambda and what in comparison with f Witten-Kontsevich?
You just put this lambda classes. Take f running point and...
Where is it? Here, I put in front some extra class, in front of monomials of psi classes, I put some extra class which depend on lambda.
If you put, so r equals 0 gives...
So r equal to 0, it's also could be treated as a deformation of Witten-Kontsevich using these parameters r. So you're right, for the initial parameter value, it is for when r equal to 0, we have Witten-Kontsevich, but when r is changing, we solve this linear equation as usual. The solution of this linear equation with constant coefficient is just exponential of this operator. So for r equal to 0, we have the Witten-Kontsevich, and then it's modified in this way. So I write here the Bamford equation in terms of not exponent, but in terms of the function itself, as usually. The nonlinear terms should be added in this way, in this case. And these are the equations. So whenever dependence of r on the parameters, I write in this way, and you get 0. So when I start to move in the space of r parameters, I know how to change our potential. So I can go along any curve in the space of r parameters, and I will restore our potential. So now the statement is that this function also admits topological recursion of the same sort. It is formulated in a slightly strange way using so-called Laplace transform. The word Laplace transform appeared already in the talk of Dima. And also I use the same term, but let me say what a Laplace transform is. From my point of view, Laplace transform is just a linear isomorphism of the space of Lorentz series in the variable x and in the variable z. This is a coordinate isomorphism. If I have a monomial z to the power n here, then I just take the same exponential x to the power n here, but rescale it with a certain factor to the power n divided by 2n minus 1 factorial, double factorial. So just a linear space, a linear isomorphism of two vector spaces. So given a series, you can represent it on the left-hand side or on the right-hand side just by rescaling the Taylor coefficients. The same formula, by the way, could be applied both for positive and negative n, because the negative double factorial of negative odd number is well defined, and it's just the two formulas are equivalent. Both formulas could be applied for positive and negative n. I use multiplication when I use topological recursion. I use multiplication in this space, and this isomorphism, of course, does not preserve the multiplication. So it's not multiplicative isomorphism. When I speak about multiplicative structure in our space H, I will use this presentation of this space. But on the right-hand side, I have a nice operator of multiplication by Z here. But if you take just multiplication by Z, it looks very simple here. But here you have some strange scaling factors, because on the left-hand side, this turns to be a differential operator. Minus. So you can consider this Laplace transform as follows. You can ignore the right-hand side. You have this space of Laurent polynomials. But Z inverse is just treated as a notation for this differential operator. So the new data which I introduce for this space of Laurent series is this extra differential operator, first order differential operator. Now the prescription is as follows. The basis that I use is very simple if you use the right-hand side of the Laplace transform. I start with a series R, which is given by this exponential. So small r are the same as the parameter of my family. So I obtain this series R of Z, and this series, which is corresponds to the basic vector number zero, the space which I denote by V. And on the right-hand side, this is just a series in Z. On the left-hand side, you should rescale the coefficient to obtain the corresponding basic vector in the X coordinates. And then in order to obtain basis, you just act by multiply by a suitable monomial in Z on the right-hand side, and respectively, I should apply this operator in the left-hand side. So this basis looks very nice. So I obtain the basis in vectors on the right-hand side, which looks very nice in the right-hand side of the Laplace transform. But in the left-hand side, you should use these strange factorial coefficients.
And the duality is given by residue, as usual.
I will speak what do I mean by duality, but later, if you don't mind. And so I claim that you should apply to this basis. So we have this basis Xi n, which is z to the power n r of z here, and which correspond to certain series on the left-hand side. And also we have minus 1 to the power n plus 1 z to the power z to the power n plus 1 r of z on the right-hand side, which corresponds to xi n here. So these are regular in X, and these are Laurent half poles. So the V is the linear span of this Xi n star, which is easy to see that it is just the same as before. this the space of regular functions. But L is different. In the case of Witten-Kontsevich or Weyl-Peterson, it was just coordinate supplementary subspace. But now it's not coordinate, it's just linear span of these vectors, which is slightly turned subspace in the space of Laurent series. And also, the recursion requires also the choice of the vector eta, and eta is equal to, according to my notation, something like xi 1 star, which is 2 times x plus high order terms. It's also some deformation of the function tx in the Witten-Kontsevich. And you see it works. Just apply the same relations. These relations, they do work. So this implies recursion. Again, if you extract terms of degree g and n in h and t, then you obtain this recursive procedure to recover a homogeneous component of this potential. And in particular, if you, for the choice of parameter values using these Bernoulli numbers, you have specialization of this for Hodge integrals involving single lambda classes or Hurwitz numbers. And this is what Dima mentioned in his talk. It's so-called Bouchard-Marini conjecture. The Bouchard-Marini conjecture claims that the certain recursion for Hurwitz numbers or the same as for Hodge integrals. And if you remember, it was related to the, it was related to certain spectral curve. The spectral curve of this recursion is so-called Lambert curve. I use a slightly, my notation is differ from those used in talk of Dima by slightly shift of variables. So I use the, this is a Lambert curve. I use the coordinate system such that the critical point of the projection to the x-line is the origin. So if you expand the logarithm, is what this is x squared or y squared over 2 minus y cube over 3 plus y cube fourth over 4 minus and so on, right? So it's something like this. And there is a involution that exchanges the preimages of the projection to the x-line. The projection to x-line is double ramified degree 2 cover. So there is a involution which exchanges this two points. And let me denote this involution somehow by bar. This is slightly misleading notation because it's nothing to do with the complex conjugation, but however it's used everywhere in papers devoted to this recursion. And also, let me introduce an odd coordinate, which is given by this equation. So in this notation, S bar is equal to minus S. So this is a S is another local coordinate on our curve. And this is how the function y looks in the S coordinate. X becomes just S square over 2. And if you look carefully at the recursion, the form of inner and 10, then it happens that it depends only on the odd components of this function y. So you can freely modify the even components. They are not participating in the recursion. The whole recursion will be the same. So you can a huge variety of possibilities to change the spectral curve of the which produces just the same recursion. If you modify anyhow the even components, the recursion which will remain the same. So I treat this Lambert curve just as a job of a curve as origin. If you write it in this way, then it happens then y extends as a global coordinate on the affine coordinate on this line, but the recursion uses only the germ of the curve as the origin. So if you just are interested in the computing the coefficients, you need only odd part of this. And then let's compute the derivative of this odd part over S. And it happens that this series is related to the series that I used in my formulation by just Laplace transform. So here are two functions. So the first one is given by these Bernoulli coefficients, and the second one is given by this derivative of the odd part of the y coordinate. So I do not formulate the recursion in terms of the spectral curve. This will be done probably in in the next talk. But just to make the correspondence uses this strange peculiar identity. In this lemma, I use the reference B and M. If you think that this is Bouchard-Marinho, that it is not correct. The correct reference is this one. I observed this lemma in a strange paper of these guys from Mathematical Institute in Venezuela. This lemma in this exactly form was proved in this paper. And this paper has nothing to do with Hurwitz numbers, with topological recursion. And it happened that these coefficients, which appear here, appear in a slightly different problem not related to the subject of our talk. It deals with the asymptotic expansion of gamma function. So if you take n factorial, then you know the Stirling formula, something like n over e to the power n, right? And there are correction terms of the asymptotic expansion, which are exactly those.
And there is a square root of 2 pi n. 2 pi n.
Well, n here.
Sorry.
Okay, but this is, you know, better, but this is
get odd powers. Okay. It's still in formula. Sorry. It's exponent of some odd powers. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. If not exactly this, but very close to this. Anyway, this series appears in the asymptotic correction terms of the asymptotic expansion in the Stirling formula. By the way, if you put n to the power of n to the left-hand side, you will observe this formula, which is close to what was used in the talk of Tima Zvonkin and so on. So it's really related, but not directly. Okay, so these. Huh?
You have, in your case, you have the same coefficient as here.
Yes, I did the following. I observed this recursion for Hurwitz numbers. I obtained this series, and then I put these coefficients, numerators, and also enumerators in the, in how it's called, the table, the library of sequence, encyclopedia of sequences, and they give me this reference.
But maybe it is related because the...
of course it's related, yeah.
The last transform of the Lambert function is the gamma function. Mm-hmm. So you're just expanding the Laplace transform, and so...
Yeah, of course, yes. Yeah,
so. But you get the expansion of the gamma function.
So I think that I finish with my examples, and now I'm ready to give the more general form of the recursion, which covers more or less all the cases treated by Inarion 10. And I still have time, probably I will start. These definitions, then probably. Which one? And
just before you raise the
I will keep this. because I just copied this because
that remains completely mysterious.
Yes, it looks like. So I just think that if you just, one of the ways to get use of this formula is just to repeat it many, many times. So I use this principle.
Would you explain how one is supposed to, I don't know, to guess what, just to speak to the God or what, how one is supposed to?
According to the, according to the general principle, the new ideas come not because people start to believe in this, but because comes a new generation which do not pose this question why it works. So it, I don't know.
So that's why you're keeping it on the blackboard. You get used to it and then
Ah, by the way, let me just also, before I go further, let me play a little bit with this formula. Especially, it looks very nice in this form. There is a strong temptation to denote this u tilde is equal to u plus t minus eta. And to write this formula in the following form, h is equal to h u plus u squared is equal to o of x. It's an even more compact form. So the first remark that this function u tilde combines terms of different nature. So this is a point of L. And this is a point of complementary space V. So in what do you use in the what do you are going to compute are the terms of this expansion, but these are of different nature. They belong to a different space. So I do not like to put them together. But if you wish, you can also include them into consideration. And this is what does correspond in the presentation of Dima to W0M. And you should recognize, where is it? So if you compare with the talk of Dima, you should recognize that this is a hidden form of the Bergman kernel. And this is what Dima wanted to add into the consideration, to add this to the right-hand side to make it in more symmetric form. So in my case, the formula as it appears in the paper of Ernar and Tarantin is too huge, it occupies many lines, so it's painful to add some extra terms. So you can combine these two terms formally if you denote this T formally as, you could define this as formally as 0, 2, and then this will be included here. But I still prefer not to do this. For me, you 0, 2 is still 0. There are no such terms. Well, another thing is about this summand 1/8x. Okay, let me take the simplest case of Wiesen-Kontsevich, and let me try to compute delta of t. What is delta of t? So when I wish to interpret this as a delta of u, I should compute delta of t. So by definition, the sum from n0 to infinity, what do we have? Xi n, which is 2n plus 1 double factorial over 2x to the power n plus 1. And times the derivative of t over tn. But the derivative of t over tn, derivative of t over tn is xi star times 2x to the power n over 2n minus 1 double factorial is equal to sum from n to 0 to infinity. What do we sum up? 2n plus 1 over 2x, right? So you get a divergence. And therefore, we regularize this by definition. This is 1 over 8x. So this is just a convention. So if you add this convention, then you can write the formula in this more compact form. This convention comes exactly because it should be like this if you wish that it works for the Wiesen-Kontsevich potential. But I do not want to speculate with divergent series, so I prefer to keep the formulas in this form. Okay, I would erase this. Okay, so now we played a little bit with examples, and I think that you're ready to accept the general definition. So now I will give the general definition of topological recursion in the form that I prefer. I start with some H with a finite dimensional. Frobenius algebra. It means that it is associative, commutative, and also with unit. And also equipped with a scalar product, which is invariant for multiplication, which is given by a linear function, such that is a non-degenerate quadratic form, bilinear form. So N stands for the dimension of this vector space. And in all my previous examples, H was just C, one dimensional. And now I will consider a more general case. The typical example is so-called semi-simple Frobenius algebra, which admits a basis of idempotence. So we have a basis which I denote E1 star, E sub n star, such that multiplication, it looks like EI times squared is equal to EI. And for different indices, they star. So this basis is automatically orthogonal, necessarily. But it's not necessarily orthonormal. And so let me use a dual basis E1, En. The dual basis, it's proportional to this one. And EI, I don't remember. Well, probably 1 over delta IEI. I don't remember the conventions that I prefer. So let me think where I wish to put the star. Probably, yeah, like this. So that the unit is sum of EI star. And also, when you use the scalar product, you should take this factor. And also, I will need the Casimir element, which is independent of the choice of the basis, which is in this particular case, is the sum of delta I EI star. It's idempotent. It's an idempotent. So this is a basis. So whatever is this element, it should be expanded in the basis. And these are coefficients of this expansion. And also, all this delta I should be non-zero. This is one of the typical examples. And the case which corresponds to the recursion of an RR antenna, how it appears in most papers, it corresponds exactly to this case. And moreover, for the choice of these factors, all are equal to 1. But it happens that in applications, usually one has a, so for instance, the length of the unit vector is equal to sum of delta i's. So in applications, it happens that the norm of the unit vector is equal to 0. So it's the convention when all delta I is equal to 1 is not physically meaningful. Another typical example is cohomology ring or even cohomology ring of some complex manifolded. This is the way how it appears in quantum cohomology and Gromov-Witten theory. So this is Frobenius algebra that I fix for once and for all. I will consider the deformations of initial data of the topological recursion, and the Frobenius algebra itself will never be deformed. I fix it once and for all. The next step is to consider the algebra that I used in my examples, H. This is the space of Laurent series in one extra variable with coefficients in H. How to put probably, but it's better to put H in front. I will write it simply like this. Okay. The space of Laurent series in X valued in H. And you can multiply elements using multiplication in H. So this becomes an algebra. And this space is symplectic. There is a peculiar symplectic form in this space given by the following formula. So if you take ax to the power k, bx to the power l, it's non-zero only if k plus l is equal to minus 1, plus 1 is equal to 0. And in this case, is equal to a the pairing of a and b times the coefficient, some extra coefficient, which is I'm not sure about this factor 2, 2k plus 1. So because of this property, it's skew symmetric. If you replace k and l, the negative sign will appear. Let me write this in more invariant way. If you have two Laurent series valued in H, then you do the following residue.
Can you explain why it's skew symmetric?
If k plus l plus 1 equal to 0, then 2k plus 1 and 2l plus 1 different by sign. So if make a substitution, my favorite substitution, instead of x, I put s squared over 2. Ds. And for g's, I do the same. And then I take the primitive of this. The primitive is defined up to a constant, but the constant does not contribute to the residue. So this is the way how it's defined, and this is obviously skew symmetric. Okay, then the next object in this space. By the way, if you use this, if you use this symplectic form, that one can produce many convenient Darboux bases, and one of the possible Darboux bases is the following. So I use the elements with two indexes, n nu k, which is E sub nu star times times 2x to the power k over 2k minus 1 factorial, double factorial, and the dual basis xi nu k, this is using with star, and without star, this is I nu times 2k plus 1 double factorial 2x to the power of k plus 1. So if you use this basis, it's a Darboux. So the pairing between so here nu runs from 1 to dimension of the space, and k from 0 to infinity. So if you take the pairing between two vectors with the same indices, you get 1 up to a sign and 0 in all other cases.
But you could also use a Z basis of it.
Yes. There is another presentation of this space using Laplace transform. I will discuss it later. Okay. So in particular, these vectors span the regular part of this, which I denote by V. So V, subspace V, is subspace V is just a regular part of this H. So at the moment, I have no data to use for the recursion, because all this can be used for any
So V is the other half.
Huh?
V is the other half, right? It's the regular in X.
Regular in X.
Yes. So it's not the one that you underlined.
Oh yes, you're right. Sorry.
No.
No.
Thank you. Okay. No.
I correspond to this.
It's important, so probably I wish to emphasize. So this is. Yeah. So this is this particular case. This is just complementary coordinate subspace consisting of Laurent polynomials, or polynomials in 1 over x. But now the data of the recursion that I do need is L. And by definition, L is a Lagrangian subspace. In H, complementary to V. So this coordinate subspace spanned by these vectors is just one of the examples. But of course, there are many more different Lagrangian subspaces. And to be precise, I also need a basis. Xi alpha is a basis in L, and also Xi alpha star is a dual basis in V. So the symplectic structure makes these two subspaces dual to one another. And so I fix some symplectic, some basis here and some dual basis here, and they together form a Darboux basis in the ambient space H. Actually, the explicit form of this basis is not so important, but for the matter of computations, so to make some explicit computations, I need also to fix this basis. By the way, I can change one of the bases, and then this produces the change of the other basis. For instance, I can use a coordinate system such that this is a standard basis. The actual basis could be different, but if Xi alpha star Xi alpha is the same as there, nu k, wait a minute. How to say? I mean that Lagrangian subspaces are parameterized by quadratic forms. So let me formulate this in the following way. So consider our space V and the complementary space L. And also I will use the coordinate space L0. L0 is the coordinate space which was used before, for which consists of polynomials in X inverse, right? So here we have chosen the basis Xi alpha. Here we have a dual basis, which I denote by Xi alpha. And also there is a basis here, which is also dual to this one with respect to pairing. But if you use L0 instead of L, I denoted this way. Then the difference between these two bases due to duality should be vertical. Plus certain vertical vector, which is parallel to this one, so it belongs to V. So this is element of V. And
then what is upstairs should be Xi nu k zero.
No. Xi zero, it's some basis of L zero.
No. So Xi zero, Xi with upper zero, it's a single symbol. And alpha runs over all the basis which has
to be. It's projection to Xi alpha to L zero, yeah.
Yeah, so
the basis in V is fixed.
But
it's everywhere.
Well,
it works also for Xi0 or not?
You can use different bases, but let's for a moment fix the basis here, and these are both dual to this one, but with respect to different Lagrangian subspaces. Then actually L is Lagrangian. Is just a reformulation of the fact that this B is symmetric. And again, as before, I use T is a sum of T alpha Xi alpha star, the generic element of V. And also I will need some eta some particle fixed point of this family. It's a some this is some specialization of this one, and it should be of the following form. Some invertible element times x plus high order terms.
So V is always a subalgebra in this.
V is always subalgebra. Yeah.
But your basis psi alpha, is it the same as the...
This is one of the possible choices.
But you don't assume that it's the same.
Hmm?
You don't assume that it's the same.
Yeah, so for instance, for the Hodge potential, it was different. For Witten and for Witten and for Weyl-Peterson, it was like this, but for the Hodge case, it was different. So this is the initial data of recursion. Now I can formulate the main recursion. And actually, it's actually written here. This is the main equation of the recursion. So what we do, we use here multiplication. In order to apply this multiplication, we use ring structure in H. This delta uses also multiplication. We differentiate the coefficients with respect to parameters and then multiply by this psi alpha using multiplication in H. And again, this equation could be written in compact form, like master equation. The only thing that I promised to tell you what's the initial data of this recursion, and the initial data of this recursion require to put here some special choice of the here. And
data, you mean genus
zero? Huh?
When you say initial data, you mean genus zero?
The initial data, if you remember, was if you need to fix U11 and U03.
Yeah, okay.
So the actual choice of this is the following one. If I hope that I will write correctly. Here I should put C over 8x. C is a Casimir element. And also plus some contribution, which actually affect only this U11. And this is written in the following form, psi well, some B alpha beta, Xi alpha star, Xi beta star. So Xi alpha and Xi beta both regular functions. Therefore, when you multiply, you still obtain a regular function. If you increase the indices alpha beta, then the order of this function is getting greater and greater. Therefore, you have only finitely many terms, which contribute to this U11. I will speak more about the reason for this choice of the initial data, but let me now formulate the theorem. So first of all, you may just apply directly this recursion. This choice of also contains the definition of U11 and U03. Then you apply this recursion, you find UGN for all GNN. And therefore, this UGN is uniquely defined by the recursion. Then the second statement is the following. So this, I recall you, that's UGN is an element of the space V. The space L of L and the same, they claim that it is polynomial. It means that there are only finitely many non-zero terms here. Only finally, this sum is finite, actually, only finitely many non-zero term. And each individual coefficient of this expansion is a polynomial in T. So actually, on the right-hand side, for each G, N, and alpha, we have only finitely many terms. The next assertion, so that this U satisfies the condition of mixed equality of mixed derivatives. And so it could be integrated as a differential of a function. This property depends heavily on the fact that our subspace is Lagrangian. And moreover, this condition is, this initial condition is also used very much in the proof of this this property. If you just vary slightly the initial condition, that this property will fail. So strangely, this is very subtle, it looks very natural, but actually the proof is somewhat delicate, but this is true. So actually the recursion could be applied for any L and for any initial condition because they're unique. So the first and the second line does not use the Lagrangian property of L. But the third property is, in the third property, this is crucial. And so this is implies that you can recover FGN such that UGN is differential. For instance, you can use the earlier formula. But this, unfortunately, holds only if n is positive. Because having a differential of a function, we can recover the function itself up to a constant. So in the examples that I considered before, for instance, for the Kontsevich-Witten potential, this constant was always zero. But it happens that we cannot assume that it is always zero. Therefore, there should be some way to recover the constant term corresponding to n equal to 0. So it happens that this potential has many other nice properties, and one of these is that it obeys so-called satisfied by so-called Dilaton equation. Which says that if you differentiate it in the direction of the vector eta, and let me check the homogeneity condition, n plus 1 probably, because we differentiate once. So here, this is a 2g minus 2 plus n times fgn. Yeah. So this holds. We already defined f for n equal to greater than zero. So it always holds for those values of n where f is defined. And hence, since this equality holds, we can use this equality to define f g zero is the same way. So now we defined this, all the components by yes 2g minus 2, yeah, right.
So for g equal 0, it's still defined?
And we said by definition, so in this, where is this? By definition, we said f gn is equal to 0 for 2g minus 2 plus n non-positive. So f 0, 0, f 0, 1, f 0, 2, and also f 1, 0, all these are equal to 0. There are many nice properties for this potential, but tomorrow I will discuss how it varies under variation of the Lagrangian plane. So there is a Giventhal's quantization of symplectic quantization of quadratic Hamiltonians. So tomorrow I will discuss its dependence on the choice of Lagrangian space. But now let me mention several obvious properties. The first one is the following, that to what extent the choice of eta is important. So the first property is the different of eta leads to a shift of the t variables. So if you look at this equation, the t enters always with the combination t minus eta. And t minus eta is the sum of t alpha minus eta alpha times xi alpha star. So it's a different choice of eta leads to just shift of the t variables. And we observed this fact when we used the Weyl-Peterson generating function. So the shift of the t variables is equivalent to a different choice of eta. And another property is what happens if you choose a different basis. Different choice of the basis of the basis in V or in L leads to the corresponding linear change in T. Again, if you look at these formulas, it has a more or less invariant meaning, and that the actual choice of the basis is not involved. So the conclusion is as follows. So the conclusion. So we can treat F So this f could be treated as a formal function on V. The formal function is well defined independently of the choice of the basis. But if you are interested in particular Taylor coefficients, you need to fix a coordinate system. So the particular choice of the basis leads to a particular coordinate system on V, so we need to fix basis. But if you just consider the abstract formal function, it's well defined on V and even does not depend on any choice of any basis.
Yeah. But function in formal neighborhood of point t. Right?
But moreover, we take the expansion of this function not at the origin. Expanded at certain point, probably minus eta. So the function itself is well defined, but like this. So this is a space V, and we do not know how to expand this function in the origin, but we know how to expand it at the point minus eta. A different choice of eta leads to a shift of arguments, and this condition on eta varies. I erased. This condition on eta means that if you change these terms, the corresponding variation of the function is well defined. The shift of the argument in the direction of these dots is a well defined operation. The function, everything is polynomial in this direction. So actually, it means that this potential has an invariant meaning, and it's determined by a Lagrangian plane. So essential part of this definition of the potential is Lagrangian plane, and all the other things are just coefficients which are used in the for the particular choice of coordinate system.
So F depends on L, on the choice.
Invariantly, the invariant meaning of F is it actually is uniquely determined by L. Okay. And then the other property is its variation with respect to L and also relation to Gromov-Witten theory. This will be tomorrow. Okay. Now I filled all 2 hours. Thank you very much.
Live question. So they had some applications of towards communication with gender time. So any course one theory is applicable.
Yeah, I think that, that it's better to postpone your question to the next talk. The next talk will be mostly devoted to huge, huge amount of new different applications of this for bigger N, right?
It's you, my talk?
No.
No, my next talk is mine.
Ah.
So I can short talk for 1 hour.
No, but a simple example is Gromov-Witten.
Yeah.
Gromov-Witten, yes. So you speak now, no?
No, I will speak
after the
run.
Okay. So,
Maxim, I have a short idiotic question concerning the setting. So you said that the initial data is U11 and U03. I do see U11. I do not see U03 anymore.
Let me, I will write here, probably. U11 is equal to, where is the formula? Wait. Ah, here it is. Here, PL of 1/2 times eta of this C over 8x plus some B alpha beta xi alpha star xi beta star and U03 is equal to PL 1/2 times eta of T squared.
That explains the fact that it depends on the Lagrangian L explicitly,
yeah,
because the quadratic form beta alpha B alpha beta depends on L, as
yeah,
we have shown.
And also projection also depends on Lagrangian.
So once you have the starting point, everything depends.
Mm-hmm.
Are there questions?
So what's the precise relation with Giegenthaler construction?
This is the subject of tomorrow's talk.